Hello, everyone, and welcome to our live webcast, IP Protection for Device and Machine Manufacturers. We want to thank Accenture and especially their Security Working Group for giving us the opportunity to speak about a topic which is of the essence in our modern days. My name is Daniela Previtali, Global Marketing Director of Vibu Systems, and I am delighted to have you all here with us today. We are joined by Rüdiger Kugler, VP Sales and Security Expert from the headquarters of Vibu Systems in Germany. At Vibu Systems, we empower software publishers and intelligent device manufacturers with cutting-edge technologies, new business models, and tailor-made consulting training that help them upgrade, optimize, and automate their entire license lifecycle management and ultimately monetize their business at a higher level. With the digital transformation underway, know-how piracy no longer affects traditional office software developers alone. Entire sectors of industry are at risk, from automation to healthcare, from critical public infrastructures to the financial world. No matter who we are talking about, the paramount first step is to assess the technical and digital assets that make up their IP. This is what they need to safeguard using appropriate and effective means like encryption, authentication verification, and integrity protection, in combination with secure elements aimed at keeping the secrets safe. Some housekeeping we need to take care of before we start. For everyone who's joining us today, I want to remind you that we will be reserving some time at the end of the session for Q&A. And I'd like to invite you to submit any question you have in the live chat box anytime throughout the event. Feel free to type your questions in Italian. Towards the end of the session, you will be finding the slide deck of today's presentation directly in the GoToWebinar platform. Without further ado, I'll pass things over to Rüdiger. The floor is yours.
Yes, thank you very much for the introduction, Daniela, and hello also from my side, buongiorno to all the attendees here. And in the next 50 minutes, I want to speak about IP protection for device and machine manufacturers. At the beginning, I just put some analysis from the Business Software Alliance and from the BDMA. Both are doing analysis on an annually base where they check how many pirate copies or how many vendors are affected by pirate copies, by counterfeits of their machines, of their software. And the Business Software Alliance, they are taking care about software which is running on normal standard PCs. And what we see here is just a snapshot of this of the study about Western Europe, and we see that there is a slightly decrease of the pirate copy rate from 2013 to 2017, but it is still high enough. So we have still average of more than 30% pirate copies in Western Europe. So one third of the software which is running in Europe is still a pirate copy. And if you take a look especially at the worldwide, then we see that in Asia Pacific, at Eastern and Central Europe, the pirate copy is more than 50%, also Africa, Latin America, and only Western Europe and North America pirate copies are less than the 50% percentage. If you take a look at the commercial value of the unlicensed software in use, then we see that there are multiple billions of values which are not realized by the software developers, software publishers, which are not get paid for their intellectual property. And if you take a look at this, so the outcome is that in the last years the pirate rate has dropped. So software publishers started to do a better enforcement, more ticket rights management on their software, but not all of them did it. Not all of them did it very strong enough, and so it has decreased a little bit. But it's still a very high number of pirate copies which are used all over the world. In the companies, the CIOs say, oh, it's an important thing to make sure that we are not using unlicensed software because this is very risky and expensive if someone finds out that we are using unlicensed software. And so also the awareness, especially in Europe or in the US, is already very, very high. And so also the improving software compliance is now an economic enabler, and it's very important for security. And organizations take meaningful steps today to improve their software management and to achieve the goals that they don't use unlicensed software. But as we see, it's still a very high rate of unlicensed software all over the world. The VDMA, Verband Deutscher Maschinen- und Anlagenbau, so it's a German organization, and they take care of people who build machines and complete plants. And in their study, they found out that the number of companies which are affected by pirate copies is very high. It's 71% in 2018. And so there are multiple or many companies, nearly all companies, are or have already suffered from pirate copies or from fake of their machines and devices. And we see this is overall technology, so there is no one special market, niche or brand which is not covered by this. So it's really going over all technologies and all in industries. And when we take a look at the next slide, then we see that nearly everything is counterfeited. There are components, industrial designs, entire systems are counterfeited, spare parts, catalogs, images, publications, documentation, manuals, software, and nearly everything is copied. And the takeaway of this are that nearly two-thirds of all enterprises in Germany have already suffered from pirate copies and from brand piracy. And the damages are very high, 7.3 billion every year, which if you compare this to the amount of jobs which could be paid with this, is 32,000 jobs every year. And so counterfeits are not only a security risk, they're also a safety risk. So if a user is using a wrong machine, there could be a lot of safety risk also in using these machines. And a very interesting point is that the pirate copies are not coming from the users themselves. So typically there are resellers, unauthorized resellers, which say, oh, we have the original German, Italian, France, British product, and we are the reseller here in Africa, here in Asia, here in South America. And we are selling these original machines and you can buy them from us. And then the user thinks he purchases a real machine or a real device, but at the end he gets a counterfeit. And lots of users are not aware that they are using unauthorized copies or unauthorized devices. And this makes it very hard to find out. Yeah, this were just a few samples from the studies. And I'm now working in this area since more than 25 years, for Vivo now since 19 years. And in this 25 years working in the software protection field, I heard a lot of very interesting stories. And I brought six stories with me here. Of course, I'm not allowed to tell the names, but I think the stories are also very interesting without the real names of the customers. And one is I would call this the 99 plus one case. And in this case, we had a German manufacturer of machines, and they wanted to, or they equipped a plant in Bangladesh. And the machines are available in different versions, so the hardware is the same, but the software says if the machine has the full functionality or if the machine has different functionalities. So at the end, the manager of the plant says, oh, we need 99 machines which have just the cheapest or easiest set of functions activated. And we want to have one machine with the full function set so that we can also do some special embroidering on this machine. But for all of our customers, for the most customers, the simple embroidery stuff is enough, and so we buy 99 very simple machine and one machine with the full function set. I guess a few of you could already guess the rest of the story, but let's take a look at this, at the rest of the story. So once there was a maintenance work which needs to be done, so a German service engineer visited this plant, and it was quite interesting that he found out that all 100 machines were working with the full function set. And so they copied the software and the licensing functionality from the full function to all the other 99 machines. And so they purchased it for a very small price, but now they could use 100 machines with the complete function set. So this was one case I heard 10 years, 15 years ago. So this is a very, very old case, by the way. Another case which is very similar to this is the support call of the unknown Chinese customer. And also a German manufacturer which sells machines worldwide. And in this case, he sold the machine to China. And he got a support call from a Chinese customer. His machine is not working, and there is this and this problem and this and this error message, and he could not help this, and also his local trader or dealer could not help him, and that's why he's calling directly the German headquarters and asking, could you help us? And then the engineer in the headquarters looked in the database, okay, let's find this machine number and let's find who is the customer, let's find all the history so that maybe we can help him better. And he found out, no, this customer is not in our database. And so he asked, oh, could you send me some pictures of the machine? And it was very interesting. So the machine looked like the same. So it have the same names on it. So it looked really like this German machine. And the German machine manufacturer used the dongle. And the dongle was also in the machine. And then they found out, oh, this dongle has a different color. And so it's not the original dongle that we deliver with our machine. And by the way, a dongle is a hardware copy protection device, which can be used to protect software against copying and piracy. Yeah, and what happened? And so this Chinese trader, reseller, he had pirated the whole machine. So he rebuilt everything from the steel, from the software, from all the other parts of the machine. And then they just cracked the software. So they removed the old dongle. By the way, it was not a dongle from Weibo. So they removed the old dongle from the software. And due to the fact that they know that something against pirate copies is very important in China, that's why they took another dongle and they included the other dongle in their own product. So they re-dongled this with a different product. And so at the end, the German support numbers were not removed from the software. And this was the fault that they made. Otherwise, nobody would have found out that there is a pirate copy of this machine in this plant in China. And so at the end, the user had a problem, the Chinese reseller couldn't solve him, and so they were so desperate that they called the German number, and yeah, this was how this machine how this story gets to the knowledge of the developer. Another also very interesting use case is finding your own software, restricted software on eBay. So there was a car manufacturer, and they have a CD with their corporate information, so it's information about their car, so the weaknesses of the car, so it was specially made for their service garages who should do some repair and maintenance work on the machines or on the cars. And so it's very important to find out, oh, this is a weak point, and so after 50,000 kilometers this should be replaced by another part and so on. And it also shows how to do this maintenance work. And so they thought this is very important to protect this. On one hand, they don't want to have this as a public information for the press. So the press should not write, oh, for this cars, they will break down after 50,000 kilometers for this and this. And on the other hand, they want to make sure that only authorized partners should be able to do maintenance and repair work. Yeah, and so at the end, they had this CD-ROM, and they found this CD-ROM on eBay. And then they thought, oh, we put some copy protection on the CD-ROM, so maybe it's a fake. And so they purchased this CD-ROM on eBay, and what they find out, oh, this is really our information, and the protection was cracked. And so, yeah, also documents could need some copy protection. The next use case is a very interesting one. Also, not only in the last few years, it's also a story now 6, 5, 7, maybe 7 years old. And currently, pay-per-use is something which is very common, and software developers, software vendors want to use pay-per-use models to get more turnover with their software. But this is a sample where pay-per-use was already used since multiple years. In this case, is a manufacturer of dental prosthesis milling machines. And they say we have two different business models. On one hand, we have our customers who want to buy the machine, and then they can do everything with the machine. And then we have some laboratories and they don't have so much money. They could not spend the money for the whole machine, but we also want to get them as a customer. And so we have a different business model where we say, oh, you get this machine for less, but you need to pay for every tooth that you mill with our machine. And so you can either get it for the full price and you are open to use every material, or you can get it for a reduced price. And then you need to buy our own block. So this is the raw material for milling such a tooth. And in this case, it's a pay-per-use that you pay for every block that you buy from us. Yeah, and so the idea was, we tag the blocks with an RFID chip, and we check if the RFID chip of the block fits to our database, and if it fits, then everything is fine, and the machine is allowed to do this. Yeah, so only the fitting blocks or blocks with an RFID chips RFID chip are allowed, and then the user just remove the RFID chip from the block, purchase the no-name block, a cheap block somewhere else, put the RFID chip on this block, just put it in the machine, and everything worked. And so also here, there was a stronger copy protection needed, and there were two bad effects here. On one hand, the vendor lost some turnover because they want, or they earned their money also with the selling of these blocks. And on the other hand, they had some warranty issues, because different material has different properties. And so if you burn such a teeth, then it could change, or it changes the size. And if you have a different material, the size could change more or less during the finishing process. And so at the end, it could not fit into the mouth, and you could lose it after 1 year, after 2 years. And so it's not that reliable as if it would be with the original material. And then the question is, who is guilty for using the wrong material? This is also a very interesting sample. The fifth sample is a very easy, just theft of internal stuff. And so I found this in the application of packaging machines. And so, company which are producing packaging machines, and the field engineer has access to the whole source code of the packaging machine. And when the field engineer left the company, this field engineer just took the source code away, and for projects of another customers, he just used this source code of the competition them, and so he made it it was easier to build up the new projects, because he didn't need to implement everything from scratch. So he just spared a lot of time, or saved a lot of time, and could implement the stuff better with the intellectual property of the competition. At the end, this was found out because he just simply copied a bug, and and this bug was in the original source, and it was very unlikely that this bug would have been done by a different developer on the same time. And so I also found a very similar sample of a hardware device, and there was a design on the PCB, And in this case, they found out, oh, we only make a small series of, let's say, 1,000 pieces of this. And so it makes no sense to change the PCB and reproduce the PCB. And that's why they just molded a small bridge over the PCB. So they have this PCB, and then there was a bridge just connecting two different pieces. And this was their fix. And later on, they found a pirate copy which has exactly the same fix, so exactly the same bridge, exactly the same wrong layout. And so typically, such things are found out if you find the same bug. So let's say a bug could be fingerprint of a stolen software. A very quite interesting finding. And last but not least, the third thing. Or the sixth thing I found is something I found very often. So this is not very specific to one customer. And this is a change of configuration. So in many use cases, a software manufacturer or manufacturer of a device is selling his device, could be an operation table, could be a blood washing machine. So you see it's mainly used for medical devices, but it could be also an ATM where you can get some money out of it. And they say the configuration should only be changed by a trained professional, because if you do the configuration in the wrong way, blood washing machines, it could really influence the health of the people which are relying on this, or also other stuff. So it could be very, very, very dangerous if something goes wrong. So so typically the configuration in such a case is protected, and it's protected with a password. And in some cases I found out passwords are the same for all devices, because the service engineer should have access to it. So the service engineer knows the password. The user, customer typically does not know the password. But if one user just see how the field engineer is typing in the password, then he also knows the password. So quite easy and simple. And it's also possible for a hacker to extract the password via reverse engineering from the executable if it is not protected, not encrypted there. So just find out where are the string tables, and is there a string like 12345 or something like this, which could be a password. And then just trying the password and finding out, oh, this is the password which was used. So in this case, or in these cases, the user was able to do an unauthorized change of the configuration. And as I told you before, I heard the same story multiple times. This blood washing devices, operation tables, or steamcraft machines, ATMs. And so this is also a thing where it's very common to need copy protection or IP protection to make sure that the user could not change the software configuration in a wrong way. Yeah, these were six examples that I found in the past. And let's just summarize which intellectual property could be protected on a technical level. And there are different types of intellectual property. On one hand, if you're producing devices, then you have some software in the device. Mostly this is called a firmware. It could be a controller, a PLC. It could be a small device, maybe based on your own hardware. It could be based on some available standard hardware, Galileo, Arduino, Raspberry Pi, something like this. And then you develop your own software, and then you want to protect this firmware, especially if you're using a standard hardware like Raspberry Pi, then it's quite easy for a hacker to just copy the software from one device to another device. And then just has it, because the device is available for everyone. He can go to Amazon or to some other online dealer, can buy this Raspberry Pi or Galileo board, and then he can just build a copy of your device. And so firmware hardly or strongly needs a copy protection in case of relying on very standard hardware. And in the past, I found that a lot of device manufacturers are, which used their own PCBs in the past, are going now to standard hardware to minimize their effort for creating such stuff. Second thing is a lot of device manufacturers also have some PC-based software, mainly for configuration of the software or of the device or for some reporting, statistic functionalities, accessing devices. And also the PC-based software includes a lot of intellectual property. Maybe you don't want to do some unauthorized stuff. And so also this PC-based software could be, should be protected. Something I heard, especially in the last 2 years, that additionally to this PC-based software, also software is running in the cloud. And the major use case here is predictive maintenance, so that the device is sending some data to the cloud. And then with this collected data, the software developer can make some predictive maintenance things and saying, oh, you should exchange this part of the machine. Otherwise, the machine could not run more in the more than 1 year. And so you should do this now to make sure that you have no interruptions in your production. And also for this type of software, some protection of intellectual property or access control for this is needed. As we have seen with the sample of the car manufacturer, also for documentation, this is important. So for PDFs, drawings, audio files, video files, and so not only software, also for documentation, this is really needed. And also report files, log files, who did some what on a machine. So which service engineer, which field engineer changed the parameters of this blood washing machine, so that later on, if something happens, they can find out who made the mistake or does someone made an unauthorized change of some stuff. And last but not least, as we've seen from the service technician and the for the packaging machines, also the source code, the code of the firmware should be protected. Yeah, so now we have seen what happened in the past. We have find out, analyzed which stuff could be protected on a technical level. So now let's dive a little bit deeper into the technical available solutions. And here I have four solutions that I want to show you. And the first is encryption of executable code. So and for this, typically symmetric encryption is used mainly due to performance reasons, because you can't encrypt the complete file with an asymmetric algorithm, because then it is too slow. And for symmetric encryption, we have the same key on the side of the software vendor, here the sender, and on the side of the user, the receiver who receives and uses the software. And so the software developer has this data, in this case the software, he encrypts the data with this shared secret key, and then he gets some encrypted data. He sends the encrypted data to the receiver. The receiver then takes this shared secret key, and he can decrypt the data and access the data. So this is the basic functionality of symmetric encryption for software, for messages, for data, for documents. So this is the basic principle for everything where you need symmetric encryption. And in software protection, this is mainly used in two different ways. On one way as a wrapper, which is something which is an envelope around the whole application or around the whole library. So it encrypts the complete executable file. It adds some protection and security mechanisms automatically to this file so that it will have some self-checks during startup. And when this executable then is started on the user side, it will be decrypted automatically because this startup code, this shelling code, envelope code is automatically added to the executable. So it will automatically decrypt and start at the side of the user. It will do some self-check, some security check. So if it is connected to a license, it will check if the license is there. If it has some integrity protection, it will check if the executable was modified, if the executable is allowed to load other libraries, if it is a library, if it is allowed to run into this executable. And so there are a lot of self-checks, tampering checks, checks of the environment, which could be implemented automatically. And a good question is, because we have seen we need the same key on both sides, on the vendor side and on the user side, where to store this key, because if the user can see the key, read out the key and hand it over to a colleague, a friend, then of course this friend could also use the key. And so there are two different approaches, and one approach is that the key is stored in the executable itself. Or the second approach is that the key is stored in a separate license, a license file, a dongle somewhere in the cloud, and so that the key is delivered independently from the executable, and only the user with the right license can decrypt the executable and start the executable. So these are the two different approaches in the wrapping technologies. The second option is to use a function encryption, which is mainly based on API. And so saying, oh, we will not encrypt the whole executable at a startup, but we will decrypt the functions when we need them in the memory. This, of course, offers a higher level of protection, especially if the users or the hacker is able to create memory dumps and is able to snapshot the functionality from the memory, put it to the hard drive, and then tries to reassemble everything together. And if everything is already decrypted, then it's not easy, but it's also not the hardest thing. But if functions are still encrypted in the memory, then it's a great puzzle game and he needs to puzzle everything together. And the more functions are still encrypted, the more complex it is for the hacker. And then, of course, we need a dynamic decryption during runtime, making sure that the functions are executed in the proper way if the software is using it, but they are could not be extracted in an improper way as long as they are not executed. Yeah, and let's take a look how this majorly works in terms of a wrapper. So this is a compiled application. It typically has a header. It has some code, some data, some resources in it. And you take a wrapper. In terms of the CodeMeter technology, we call our wrapper AX Protector. But there are many similar tools also available. So let's just simply call this a wrapper. And this wrapper will encrypt code section, data section, resource section, and it will add some security engine, which we call our AX engine, which has this automatic decryption mechanisms, which has this check at the startup, check during runtime. So everything is in this security engine. And when the software is started, then the security engine first checks license there, yes, no. And if yes, then the software will be decrypted. If no, then the user gets an error message. Sorry, the software could not be started. And if we take a look at this, this is a compiled application, and what we see that there are some readable words, Boolean, false, true, integer, cardinal, string, and so we see there are some words which are still be visible in the code. And if we take a look at a protected application, we see that we see nothing, so the code is encrypted and you cannot read anything here. In terms of the function encryption decryption, in this case, the executable is taken and we pick some functions. And the wrapper or this function encryption tool just encrypts the functions. And so the functions are only encrypted and not the rest of the executable. And then the security engine is added to the executable, which takes care of the decryption and re-encryption during runtime. Also here I have a sample, and in the sample I have a function, and this function, it starts with creating a stack frame with 5, 3, 8, B, 0, 0, D, and then there is a relocation, then there are some other terms, and at the end it ends with a C3. C3 is the return command on a sampler level, and you see this is the function that we want to protect. And when we encrypt this function, then we see that we see nothing. So at the end, the numbers are changed to some nonsense code. You see some parts could not be encrypted. That's why they are still in the same level. These are the so-called relocations. I will not dive into too many details here. And if someone tries to disassemble this code with tools like IDE Pro, then you would see that the unencrypted code would have some clear code where everything is clear and understandable. So there are some the stack frame at the beginning, the return at the end. And if he tries to disassemble the encrypted code, there is some nonsense. SBB, then a POP, then a OR with register AL, then an increment. And so this does not make any sense. And so he needs to find out that too. This does not make any sense. And so it's really hard to find out if this is an encrypted or decrypted or not encrypted function. Of course, if you have this question, can we combine both? Yes, it's possible. And so in this case, typically the tools are first encrypting the functions, and then they are encrypting the whole executable. And in the third step, they are adding the security engine to the executable. Yeah, and so both technologies, of course, can be combined together. Yeah, the second thing I want to show you is the signatures for authenticity. And in this case, we need some asymmetric encryption decryption. And so the one of the basic thing is creating a signature. And for this, we need a key pair. So and if you compare this to the symmetric stuff, we had the same key on both sides. That's why it's symmetric, same key on both sides. And the asymmetric has a key pair with two different keys on each side. So the sender has a private key and the receiver has a public key. And with the public key, you can check that the thing with the private key was done correctly. But with the public key, you could not do and perform the same operation that you can do with the private key. And so the sender has some data. He creates a hash of the data, and then he signs the hash with this signature with the private key, and then he creates a signature. So let's say he signs the data to make it more easier. Then he sends the data and the signature to the receiver. And then the receiver takes the public key, he validates the signature. Of course, he creates the hash and validates the hash to be more accurate. But let's say he's validating the signature, and then he finds out yes or no. And so if he finds out the signature is yes, then this software or this piece of data comes from the sender. So it doesn't come from someone else. And is he sure that the data was not changed? So it's authenticated and it was not changed, not tampered. So the integrity is also okay of this data block. And so this is the basic principle that we need to use here for these technologies. Yeah, and for authenticity. So typically the vendor, so the software developer, device manufacturer, signs his executable or his data with his private key. In the software, he implements his public key. And during runtime, the software can check if the signature is fine. And if the signature is fine, the software or the data really comes from the software developer, so not from someone else. And the data was not changed, tampered, alternated. So we have an integrity check, so it was not changed. And we have the authenticity check, so it really comes from this vendor. So, and of course, also signatures can be used to sign log files or report files. So if we think of our blood washing machines, in this case, each service technician, each field engineer has his own private key. And with the private key, he automatically signs the action that he does on this machine. And so later on, it could be proven who did what. This signatures have some limitations. And these limitations very easily leads to certificates. And let's take a look at the challenges or at the, let's call the limitations. The first thing is what happens if someone changes the public key? Then he could create his own signatures and say, ha, everything is fine. And so is this a real public key or is this a faked public key? In the age of fake news, why shouldn't we not have a fake public key? And what happens if I need more than one key pair? So let's assume I'm the software vendor, but I'm not a three employee company. I'm a big company worldwide, and I have a lot of build systems, daily builds, nightly builds, and I want to sign my software automatically there. I have some field engineers who should also do some signatures, and I don't want to give the same private key to everyone. So I want to have different key pairs. In this case, the solution is certificates. And a certificate could be a X509 certificate. This is a standard certificate, or it could be a, we call this a mini certificate, which is a very close to X509, but with less fields, with less restrictions to make them more handy and easier to use. And here I have a sample of a certificate. The certificate was issued for, this is a certificate for user, for my colleague Wolfgang. This was issued for Wolfgang Völker. Wolfgang is part of the company Vipu Systems. He is a member of the business unit Vipu Operating Services, shortly VOPS. The certificate has its own serial number, which identifies the certificate. It has a public key. And it was issued, so it was signed by Vipu Systems Root. And so this is just a small sample. But the question is, oh, is the certificate the real certificate or is this a fake certificate? And so for this, we need to sign the certificate with the private key of the vendor, of course, and then we can check it with the public key of the vendor in our software. And so with certificates, we have one root public key, which needs to be integrated into the software. We need to make sure that this part of the software cannot be changed, or that the software can find out of if this part has been changed. So this is something that we can do with a signature, with this integrity protection that we have already seen. And of course, we need to protect this public key against tampering. And then we can create a lot of keys, which should be used instead of the root key for the signing of the software. And we create certificates. And with this root key, we only need to sign this certificates. Or of course, we can have more than one. We can have a complete chain of keys in the certificate chain. And if a key gets stolen, then it can be revoked with the private root key. And so the private root key can say, oh, there's a revocation list, and this private key or the certificate with the serial number, to be more accurate, is no longer valid. And then the new software will get this certificate revocation list and will use it and say, oh, this certificate is now no longer available and no longer allowed to be used. The next thing is the technical solution for documents and for source code. And this is a little bit different to the software encryption itself, because in terms of the software encryption, I just reuse the same picture. We have the security engine, which is able to perform the decryption. But in terms of a document, we have no executable code in the document. It would be very bad if there would be executable code in a document. If there is executable code, this is something that a virus or the security, typically this is due to a security hole, and a virus could use this security hole or this vulnerability to execute some code. And so putting executable code in a document is a really bad idea for a real document. And so in this case, the wrapper takes the document, it will encrypt the document header, it will encrypt the data, and it will put some new header on the document so that it is now mentioned as an encrypted document. So what we see, the difference is there's no executable code, no security engine within the document. And so the application software self-decrypts, but the document needs some tool, some third-party tool, some other software for the decryption. And this is typically the challenge or the requirement for document and source code protection. We need an application, some type of viewer, some type of tool, which should decrypt the protected document and order the source code. And in some cases, there are special viewers available. There are sometimes plugins available for Adobe PDF. There is a plugin, which by the way, we are using for Siemens TIA portal. There is our plugin interface available for Rockwell Logic Studio 5000. There are plugins available. And so some vendor of such document creating or source code creating systems, IDEs, they already know this challenge or this requirement from their customers, and that's why they offered plugins to implement such an encryption, decryption for source code or for documents. Or of course, we can use our wrapping technology and wrap the viewer or wrap the executable. But in this case, something like copy paste should be prohibited, like save as needs to be controlled, that you could not easily with save as just stored as a plain file somewhere else. And so these are the challenges and requirements for document and source code protection. And so if it comes to protection of software, this is easily done and can be done for any type of software. If it comes to protection of document and source code, then it depends on the type of source code. So PDF, TR Portal, Rockwell, this is already available. But if you say, oh, I want to protect some other documents, then it's the challenge to find out which vendors are supporting which plugins, wrapping technologies, and for audio and video files, it's also available. But of course, it's not a generic solution available for every document. And so for every document, type of document, it needs to be evaluated from the scratch. A very good question that I also already covered or touched at the beginning is where to store the keys. And if we have a shared key that we need to use for the decryption of the software or private key, then this is something which should be usable for the user, but it should not be readable and copyable or copyable for the user. And so possible places are a dongle. So you can say, oh, I want to have a very good copy protection, I want to place them in the dongle. And a good dongle offers the functionality that you can put a private key or a shared key into the dongle. And then you can use this key via an API, but no one can extract and grab the key and extract it from the dongle and put it somewhere else. The second option is encrypted on the device. This at least makes it secure against just copying the license file with the encrypted data and put it somewhere else, because then it would not work if some fingerprint of the device is used for the encryption of decryption. But in this case, of course, everything is done in the main memory of the computer of the device. And in this case, it is not as secure as a dongle, but of course the solution doesn't need an external hardware. And so it's easier to implement and cheaper. So yeah, both have their advantages and of course disadvantages. And a third option where you can store the key is a server in the cloud, so that the software or the tools need an online connection, sending some data in the cloud, getting the feedback back, and then using the local stuff for the rest of the calculation, but having some part or pieces of the calculation in the cloud. Yeah, and so for high security implementations, the recommendation would be the storage in a hardware security module like a dongle. The key should be usable, but it should be not possible to extract the keys, which is exactly the definition of a hardware security module. And very often, asymmetric mechanisms are used to distribute the keys from the vendor to the user. Where to store a public key? If we think of a public key, so a public key should be stored in the software. The root public key should be stored in the software. And public keys are not secret, so we don't need to encrypt them. We can encrypt them to make them easier or more hard to find, not so easy to find. The threat scenario is something changes the public key. And so we need to make some integrity checks, authenticity checks, that the public key was not changed. And that's exactly why often obfuscation is additionally used for protecting public keys, so as an obfuscation step. I have a very small sample prepared with CodeMeter. This just takes a few seconds how to encrypt the software, .NET software, and I just want to show this to you. So we have a tool, we call this AX Protector, and in these terms I'm just starting my tool. So, and I want to protect the .NET assembly, that's why I'm picking the .NET, and I already prepared my sample notepad executable, and I just drag it here. And on the next step, I need to define which code meta license I want to use, and I just define the license number. I just will use the license number 201,000. Here, and that's it. And next, and next, and next, and next, and next, and next. And now when I click on finish, protect now, then our wrapper will automatically find out all the parts of the executable or the code sections. In this case, it will find also the functions. It will encrypt every single function, will put them together as a huge puzzle, and will then create a protected executable. And if we would take some reverse engineering tools like IDE Pro, we would see exactly the things that I already showed you in the presentation. In the unencrypted would be still readable parts, and the encrypted one has no more readable parts. And now we got a protected executable. Here it is. And if I start a protected executable, of course, I would get a message, sorry, no license found, because now in the next step, the software developer would need to create a license, would need to deliver the license as a license file, would need to deliver the license as a dongle. And then if I plug in the right dongle, the software would be automatically decrypted and would be automatically started. But this is just a very small and short demo how this can be done with CodeMeter. And so what we have seen is this can be done very easily and very fast. So let's switch back to the presentation. We need to continue presentation. So let's come to a small summary. There are a lot of different types of intellectual properties which are in devices, which are in machines, in different types of properties like software, firmware, documents, source code, and so on. And there could be people who want to steal your software, could be people who want to hack something. And the users should not be able to use the product in an unlicensed way, because if they are able to, they will do. This is something that we really learned. If there is a way around, the user will find it or will use it. And so make there some borders, barriers, so that it's not too easy for them to use the software in an unlicensed way. And at the end, my last sentence is strong protection for intellectual property is definitely needed. Yeah, so thank you very much from my side, and I like to give back to Daniela for some additional words.
If there are any question in the chat room, please feel free to share them now. You can raise your hand and we will get in touch with you. Otherwise, we wrap up and just close, ready for our lunch break. Okay, so apparently there are no immediate questions to address. So thank you, Rüdiger, for the very interesting insights you've shared with our audience today. And special thanks to all our attendees for joining us. We hope you enjoyed this masterclass as much as we did. For a deeper dive into this conversation, please contact me directly or join Vibu Systems at SPS IPC Drives in Parma, May 28 to 30. Among other activities, we'll be holding a workshop about secure digital storage and key enrollment in industrial environment. That's all, folks, for today. Have a fantastic rest of your day.